Very good afternoon, participants. Once again, it is our great pleasure to welcome you all to the Knowledge 4.0 webinar series. Under this webinar series, we have been seeing the lecture series on mechanical behavior of materials, which is being handled by Dr. V. Balasubramanian sir, who is one of the well-known person in welding and mechanical behavior. So far, past 3 days, we have been enjoying his lecture on tensile behavior, fatigue behavior, and crack growth. So today we are in the fourth day of mechanical behavior materials. So I welcome you all on behalf of Chennai Institute of Technology for this wonderful forum. And on behalf of all, I welcome Dr. VP sir once again for this forum. Welcome, sir. Please, you can go on to those sessions.
Thank you. It is clear, no?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Good afternoon, friends. This is the fourth lecture in the series of mechanical behavior of materials. Even some of the participants told me over the phone and message that yesterday, no, after 5:15, some of the slides I shown, it was not displayed. Anyway, after completing this topic, fracture toughness of the materials, then time permits, I'll show those slides, leftover slides today. Today we'll discuss about fracture toughness. It's one of the important property of the material that should be evaluated, and it has a lot of importance on the design of the component is concerned. So a brief introduction, because this fracture toughness behavior of the material normally evaluated using the fracture mechanics proper concepts, fracture mechanics concepts. So the fracture mechanics concepts means, then you should know basically how it was developed or how it was evolved, the fracture mechanics concept. The very first fracture mechanics concept, which was proposed by the Griffith, a very well-known and famous scientist in this field, fracture mechanics field. He only proposed initially some concepts or theorem mechanism for to evaluate the fracture behavior of the materials. So as all aware that all the materials, whatever the material it is, whether it's a ductile material or brittle material, the solid materials, they have stored energy. So that energy, we normally say that it's elastic energy, elastic stored energy. So that stored energy, even if you take a chalk piece, a piece of chalk piece, so that chalk piece is having some energy. That's why it is in the solid state, solid position. And when you break the chalk piece, initially it will offer some resistance. After some time, it is not able to withstand the load, whatever the load or stress we are applying, then it breaks. So it is a perfect example for the brittle fracture or brittle failure, the chalk piece. Similarly, all the materials, you take any material, metals, alloys, and the materials, they have energy. That energy is stored. That energy is stored energy is normally, it will be resisted in the elastic region. So if any crack, as I told you yesterday, always all the materials will have cracks in the order of atomic level, or in the order of nanometer level, or in the order of micron level. So some of the cracks, if the crack size is greater than the micron size, then you can detect by using non-destructive testing methods, and you can take some measures to the crack to propagate further. But if it is in the atomic level, defects are there in the atomic level, so many defects, point defects, line defects, area defects, and volume defects. And in the nanometer level, also the defects are there. Those defects are not able to detect by using the present day technology like NDT methods like radiography or ultrasonic testing. We cannot detect. So if the crack is present in the material, if it is, there is no load is applied, no stress is acting on the material, then it's not, the crack is dormant. Dormant means it will not cause any problem. Unless otherwise the stress is applied, the load is applied on the material, the crack does not cause any harm. But once the load is applied, then the crack starts growing. So when it starts grow, that is the concept given by the Griffith. So what he is saying, that is, when the load is applied on the material, if any crack of nano size or atomic size is present in the material, that crack will grow. When it will grow, the load which you are applying is greater than the elastic strain energy or the energy which is stored in the material. So when the crack is to form, you want to form a new crack surface, then the material will release some elastic strain energy. That energy is at least equal to energy required to create the new crack. Because, you know, it is also, you know, it is a resistance of the material. It is the measurement of resistance of the material for the applied load or applied stress. Okay, so the material will resist to some extent. Okay, to some extent means to its capability, to its capacity will resist. But the applied load, external load, exceeds its capacity or it exceeds its load carrying capability, then the elastic strain energy will be released from the crack tip. So that energy which is released is equal to create the new crack surface. If the energy is not sufficient, then the crack, new crack surface will not form. That means it is, the crack will not open up, the crack will not grow further. So that is the concept proposed by the Griffith. So this Griffith model is applicable for the brittle materials, not for the ductile materials. It's only applicable for brittle materials like glasses. So initially it was because now brittle failure is very, very important those days, initial days, because the brittle failures will occur without any warning, without any deformation, the brittle failure will occur. So to eliminate or to estimate or to predict, so many models were proposed, many concepts were proposed. One of the earlier concept proposed was Griffith. So in that, so if your crack is inevitable, okay, you cannot avoid the cracks. As I told you, please understand, the crack size is very, very minimal. Okay, it may be in nanometer size or it may be in the atomic size. So those cracks, it is difficult to avoid in any of the material. Okay, it is very difficult to produce crack-free materials except these single crystals. The polycrystals, if you go for polycrystalline materials, definitely there will be some sort of cracks or defects will present. So that cracks will grow. When it will grow? When the externally applied load exceeds the internal resistance of the material. So when the load is applied, what are the crack present in the nanoscale or in the atomic scale? They will create a new crack surface. When they will create the surface, the energy which is stored in the material is released. Okay, you are filling a balloon. Okay, in the balloon you are filling air. So if you make a small hole in the balloon, air-filled balloon, what will happen? The air will come out slowly. So once the air comes out slowly, then the balloon will become shrink. So similarly here, once the energy is released, the stored energy is released, that energy, if it is equal to, is at least equal to create a new crack surface, then crack will grow. So the Griffith crack model is given here. Fracture stress, sigma F is nothing but fracture stress, and the 2A is nothing but the crack length, total crack length, and sigma is the stress applied, and the 2E, that eta S is nothing but surface energy. So each surface will have energy, that surface energy, and E is Young's modulus, divided by pi into A. Pi is, you know, 3.14, and A is the half crack length. We used to say it is the half crack length. The full crack length is 2A, and the half crack length is A by 2A. The half of the 2A is A. And the square root of this value will give the fracture stress. So If you know elastic Young's modulus of the material, if you know the crack length of the crack length, and if you know the surface energy of the material, then you can find, you can predict this is the fracture stress. So what you have to do, if you know the fracture stress, if the applied stress or the stress which is employed acting on the component is lower than this fracture stress, then the crack will not grow further and the crack will not cause any problem. Okay, the crack will not cause any problem. But the applied stress is exceeding the fracture stress of the material, whatever you calculate using this equation. If it is greater than this, then crack will go and it will be, fracture is inevitable. So this is the concept of Griffith theory. But this Griffith theory, please understand, it is proposed only for the brittle solid, not for the ductile metal. It's a brittle material. So later on, the people understood that the Griffith theory is only for applicable for the brittle materials. Then Irving, another scientist, he modified the Griffith theory and he replaced the term surface energy term with the potential energy release rate, a term called G, capital G. So he changed the flow stress equation proposed by Griffith instead of surface energy. So he used a term called potential energy release rate. So how much energy is released? Okay, that is that you included in this term. That is E. E is always Young's modulus, and G is the energy release rate, and pi E, other things are remaining. So this is because this model is applicable for the even the ductile materials. For both the ductile and the brittle materials, you can apply this model and it works well. Because in the Griffith theory, it is a lot of discrepancy. When you evaluate, when you predict the fracture stress for the many materials, there is a lot of discrepancies. So this discrepancy is overcome or eliminated by the proposed by the Irving. So he introduced a term called potential strain energy release rate, G. So what is G? G is the potential strain energy release rate that is related to stress intensity factor. Yesterday also I discussed about stress intensity factor. Stress intensity factor K, that's, it is normally denoted by capital K. It is obtained from the sharp crack fracture toughness test. So if to get the stress intensity factor, and then you have to do the fracture toughness test. So these are all now related to the fracture mechanics. So the critical condition to which a crack propagates to cause global failure is when this G value exceeds critical value of G. So all the materials, there is a critical value. Okay, yesterday also we have seen in the petty crack growth, I told about delta K. Delta K is nothing but the stress intensity factor range. So the stress intensity factor range, if it exceeds a critical value, then unstable crack growth, third stage of crack growth will occur, unstable crack growth. So that is there, I mentioned as delta KC, delta K critical, CR. So that delta KCR, similarly it is here, it is the G value, if it is lower than the critical value, okay, then the crack will not propagate and the crack will not cause any fracture, any failure. But if the G value, the potential strain energy release rate, the energy released from the material through the crack tip, when you apply the stress, okay, that strain energy, the released strain energy exceeds the critical value, then unstable crack growth will occur and the failure will occur. So this is the concept. Please understand. So this, when you apply the load, if there is a crack is present, as I told you, if there is means what? Always there is a crack. The crack sizes will differ. Maybe atomic size, or it may be nano size, or it may be micron size, or it may be millimeter size. Any size, it depends on. So if you are in micron size, millimeter size, you can deduct by entity method. But if it is nano size or in atomic size, you cannot deduct. So that crack, what will do, when you apply the load, that the crack will start growing or starts growing here. Why it's growing? Because the energy which is stored in the material, it is resisting initially. But one stage, it cannot resist. Then it has to be yield. So when it's yielding, it is releasing some energy from the, whatever the energy is stored, the stored energy will be released through the crack tip. So that release, that energy which is released along the crack tip is known as the strain energy release rate. So that strain energy release rate exceeds the critical value, because that there also there is a critical value. That critical value, then fracture will occur. If it doesn't exceed, if it is lower than the critical value, the crack will not propagate and failure will not occur. This is the concept, entire concept of the fracture. Right. So coming to the topic, there are different modes of crack deformation. So the three modes generally, there are three common modes, mode 1, mode 2, mode 3. So if you look that, mode 1 is nothing but tension mode. Tension mode is the load is applied in the tensile pulling direction. Okay, when the tensile load is applied or tensile stress is applied, if the crack grow in the perpendicular direction, perpendicular axis, normal to the loading direction. Okay, loading direction is in y axis and the crack will grow in the x axis, x direction. So that is called the mode 1. So mode 1 is very, very common. It is very easy to evaluate in the laboratory conditions. So the mode 1, lot of research work, a lot of the equations, models, theorems are the developed, proposed in the mode 1 only, because it is easy to simulate in the lab conditions. Okay, so the applied load is in the y-axis. When you apply the load, and the crack will grow in the perpendicular direction. Perpendicular direction means in the x-axis, along the x-direction. So that is known as the tension mode. The another mode is, another name is opening mode. Mode 1 is always related to, denoted by, called by opening mode, because the crack will open up under the tensile stress. Yesterday also I told, in fatigue also, the crack will open up under tensile stress. But in the second mode, it is the shear, due to the shear stress. In in-plane shear, there is a two shear, one is the in-plane shear and out-of-plane shear. In-plane shear is the shear stress, you know that the plane will be opposite to each other. Here, the shear stress direction and the crack growing direction are parallel. So if you see that the shear stress is applied along the x-axis, and the crack will advance, the crack will also advance in the same, parallel to the same direction. It's not perpendicular. So it is called sliding mode. Mode 2 is a sliding mode. And the third mode is out of plane shear. It is also the third mode, also a shear mode. Shearing, the loading is shear, shearing load, but the shearing is cast out of plane. It's not in the one plane. It's like a tearing. If you tear a paper, if you tear a piece of paper, how you tear? So it looks like a tearing mode. So mode 3 is tearing. So please remember, mode 1, mode 2, mode 3. Mode 1 is tension mode. In that, crack will open up the perpendicular to the tensile axis, tensile load acting axis. And mode 2 is sliding mode. In this, the crack will open up in the along the shear plane. And in the mode 3 is a tearing mode. The shear will occur on the out of plane shear mode. These are the three modes of crack deformation. So what is stress intensity factor? Yesterday also I told, stress intensity factor is, so as from the Griffith theory and modified by the Irwin later on, then this strain energy release rate is related to the stress intensity factor. So in mode 1 failure, the plane strain condition, the relationship between G1C, that is stress strain energy release rate, G1C is nothing but G1. 1 means it is the mode 1. Okay, the failure is mode 1. The crack deformation mode G1, K1 means it is mode 1. Crack deformation mode is 1, first mode. If G2, K2 means it is second mode, mode 2. Okay, so G1C means it is strain energy release rate in mode 1 crack deformation. That is the critical value. And similarly, K1C is nothing but stress intensity factor, critical stress intensity factor in mode 1 crack deformation. Okay. So one is, it's not I, please understand, people sometimes say KIC. It is not KIC, K1C. One means it's a Roman letter 1. Okay. It's not Arabic letter 1, it's a Roman letter 1. So you have to tell K1C, G1C, like that only you have to say. Don't say KIC or GIC. It is different. So it is, these are related using this equation. G1C is equal to K1C square, 1 minus surface energy divided by Young's modulus. So if you know Young's modulus, if you know the stress intensity, critical stress intensity factor value, give. And if you know the surface energy, then you can evaluate the strain energy release rate in the critical strain energy release rate in the mode 1 crack deformation condition. Okay, so this is the stress intensity factor. And the stress intensity factor, as I told yesterday, it is can be described as the fracture toughness of material under conditions. So K1C, the critical stress intensity factor, K1C, C refers critical. Please understand, C refers critical and 1 refers, it's a mode 1 crack deformation, and K is stress intensity factor. So the critical stress intensity factor in mode 1 crack deformation is equal to fracture toughness of the material when it should satisfy some conditions. The conditions are brittle fracture in the presence of sharp crack under critical tensile loading. If these three conditions are satisfied, then the critical stress intensity factor K1C is equal to, is you can call it as fracture toughness of the material. Okay, so you see, just relate. So strain energy release rate, and you have stress intensity factor, and you have the fracture toughness. So these are all related. Okay, these are all related. So G1C you cannot measure directly. Only K1C you can measure. That is the stress intensity factor you can measure. That stress intensity factor is nothing but is a property of the material. The property is fracture toughness of the material. So once you know the fracture toughness of the material, then the stress intensity factor is known. Then stress intensity factor known, the strain energy release rate is known. Okay, if you know the strain and the fracture toughness, then you can directly relate the strain energy release rate. Okay, why these things are required? Why these parameters are to be evaluated? That should be understood. Because these are the design parameters. If you know the K1C or fracture toughness of the material, that means it is a critical value. Why it is called critical value? If the stress intensity factor is lower than the critical value, fracture toughness value, even the crack present in the component, even the crack present in the structure, there is be no need to worry. We no need to worry. We no need to replace the component. You can run the machine. You can operate the component. Nothing. There's no harm in that. But once the crack, the stress intensity factor reaches critical value, fracture toughness value, then you should replace the component. If you don't replace the component, then what will happen? The failure will occur. The failure will occur anytime after that. So this is the why it is this parameter is very, very important. So how this stress intensity factor will be calculated? K1C, that is the alpha into sigma applied. That applied means it's a applied stress, and root over pi EAC. Pi EAC means EAC means critical crack length. So critical crack means, as I told you yesterday, the crack will grow. Initially EA0, initial crack length. It will grow from 6 millimeter to 7, 8, 9, 10. Yesterday I showed you the table. So the crack will grow steadily and slowly it will grow. So once the crack length reaches a critical value, that is called critical crack length. So at that critical crack length, the stress intensity factor, the stresses, you are applying the constant stress. Okay. And the stress intensity factor is, will also become critical. So K1C is critical stress intensity factor for plane strain condition. What is plane strain condition? I'll come back to that because that is very important. And AC is critical crack length. A sigma F is the applied stress, and alpha is the parameter. It is a factor. It is a geometric factor. There's nothing but a geometric factor. So this alpha value will differ based on the location of the crack, geometry of the crack, sharpness of the crack. Okay, so all those things will decide the what is alpha is. What is alpha is? It's a magnification factor. It's nothing but magnification factor. You have a sharp crack, you have a blunt crack. The sharp crack definitely will have high stress intensity than the blunted crack. So like that, location of the crack. Where is the location? What is the shape of the crack? What is the dimension of the crack? So that will decide the alpha value. So it is a geometric factor. It is a factor. So if your crack is present, then you can apply this, then you can find out the stress intensity factor. So there are many crack geometries, it's given in the slide. So you see that through thickness crack, A, that means what? Throughout the thickness, the crack will be present. sun, and the semicircular crack is a B, and the C is semi-elliptical crack, the shape is elliptical, and the edge crack, edge of the component, there is a crack, it is called edge crack, and corner crack. So you see that K is, if it is in the case of through thickness, it is directly you apply the sigma, applied stress into root 2 into pi A. What is pi? 3.14. What is A? What is the crack length? Half crack length. The total crack length you have to take as 2A. Half of the crack length is you have to take here to calculate stress resilience factor. Because you have any crack, you have two crack tips. So in each crack tip, there is a stress intensity factor. Okay, that's why we are calculating only one half. Considering that it is a symmetric, the crack is symmetric. So you are calculating only, you are taking only half of the crack length, not the total crack length. So pi into A, square root, applied stress. If you multiply, you will get the value. That value is nothing but stress intensity factor value for the through thickness crack. Okay, for suppose if it is in the semi-elliptical crack or edge crack, you see the edge crack, the alpha is 1.12. The alpha is 1.12 because the location of the crack will decide. So it is the edge of the component or edge of the material. So it is 1.12, it's magnifying it. Okay, but the 0.6, 0.8 and all, it is reducing it. So it's not more than one, it will multiply, less than one, it will reduce the value of intensity. So 1.12 into upright stress into pi into A. Okay, so these are the different levels. If you, lot of data are available, handbooks are available for many crack shapes, crack tip radius, crack location. These values are evaluated and it is given in the handbook. You can refer those things if you want to cover it. Right, coming to the fracture toughness testing, determination of fracture toughness testing, there are many methods. Many methods are there by using LEFM, because there is a fracture mechanics, you have linear elastic fracture mechanics, plastic fracture mechanics. So there are different concepts are there. In the linear elastic fracture mechanics, there are four methods are there. K1C, fracture toughness testing. This is very widely used, very, very popular method, K1C fracture toughness testing. And then there are modifications to the K1C. The procedures are same in other case also. Only small variation in each case, CTOD, crack tip opening displacement, CTOD measurement. And J integral, if it is a small thickness specimen, you cannot evaluate K1C. So they will go for the J1C, J1, J integral. J1C is nothing but like the K1C, it is also energy release rate only, all orbital torque, R curve. Sometimes people construct R curve. We'll see one by one as long as the time permits. But I will focus more on K1C because if you understand K1C, fracture toughness first one, then other things are very easy to understand. Right. So what is the K1C fracture toughness? K1C fracture toughness, please understand again, I repeat that K1C is, K is stress intensity factor. C refers for critical, critical stress intensity factor. What is 1? Is the crack deformation mode is 1, first mode. Okay, only we are discussing about first mode, not second mode, third mode. So K1C, fracture toughness of material, is obtained by determining the ability of material to withstand load in the presence of a sharp crack before it fails. You see, there is a tube or pipe, you can say there is a crack, the length of the crack is 2C. So you can estimate, if you know this fracture toughness value of the material, you can estimate whether the crack will propagate or whether the crack will cause failure. That you can predict by using, if you know the fracture toughness value. That's why it is very important. So crack propagation will in this direction. Fracture toughness, how long the existing crack will grow until the specimen fails. Okay, it is known as the fracture toughness. That is the significance of evaluating fracture toughness. How long the existing crack will grow until this specimen. Because in industry, the component, they will do periodic maintenance, periodic checkup. So while doing periodic maintenance, periodic checkup, inspection, they will, critical component, they will inspect using the non-destructive methods like radiography or ultrasonic testing. During ultrasonic testing or radiography testing, if they come across some defect in the component, then they immediately they will not replace the component. Okay, they cannot replace the component immediately, because they can replace, but only if whether it is wanted, whether the replacement is very much required. If it is not very much required, they will not replace the component. because they will, the using the fracture mechanics concept, they will evaluate how long, how many hours or how many days or how many years it will, how many months it will take for failure. So until then you run it, okay? So you can run it, no need to change the component. During this time, you order for the replacement of component and process it and purchase it and keep it ready. Once the crack length reaches the critical value, then replace the component. So that is one type of remaining life assessment. Right, if crack is present, there are many stress components in the crack tip. So in the x-axis, y-axis, z-axis, the crack tip will have the lot of the stress distribution. Formulas are there, expressions are available. Using those expressions, one can predict what is in the x direction, what is the stress, what is in the y direction, what is in the z direction. The normal thickness is thicker, what is. So you can, if you know that, then you can, using this formula, you can find out the stress distribution in all the three directions. Right, very important thing is, this is a stress distribution in the presence of crack. So the presence of crack will differ in when, if it is present in the thin sheets, if it is present in the thick plate. Okay, so thin sheets and thick plates. Thin sheets means less than 6 millimeter, less than 6 millimeters. So if thick plates means more than, greater than 6 millimeters, 10 or 12 or 25 millimeter thick. Okay, if this, what is the effect of stress distribution under the load? If you have a crack, so this is a crack, V-shaped crack, and you see that in the thin specimen, the first one is the thin specimen. So only you have the stresses distributed in the X direction and Y direction. Y direction is maximum because it is the stress applied in this direction, pulling direction, maximum at the crack tip. And away from the crack tip, the sigma y is getting reduced if you go away from the crack tip. In the x direction, it is zero at the crack tip. And in the away from the crack tip, sigma x, away from the crack tip, the stress reaches the maximum value. Then again, it is also decreasing away from. So the crack length will have an effect to a certain extent, to a certain length. Okay, so the average stress, what you calculate, nominal stress, average stress, whatever you calculate, without considering the crack, that will be lower than the maximum stress which you are getting here using the. So that's why it is called stress intensity factor comes here, comes into play. Because at the tip of the crack, stress will be magnified. Magnified means it is crossing even yield strength, crossing the yield strength also. So that's why it is called stress intensity. Stress, how much is the stress is intensified because of the presence of the crack. And in the second picture, it's a thick specimen. Thick specimen means the thickness is considerable. So in that case, you see that in all the direction, x direction, y direction, z direction, you have the stress distribution. Stress distribution is there in all the three directions. Okay, so this thin specimen, which is only you have stress distribution in x direction, y direction, that condition is called as the plane stress condition. Plane stress condition. So the thickness is, though the thickness is there, but it is negligible. The stress distribution will be there in the thickness direction, in the z direction. But that stress distribution is very, very, very minimum. So they are neglecting it. They are neglecting it, or they are taking this sigma z in the z direction, the stress they are taking as zero. If the stress in the z direction, that's the third direction, other than x and y direction, is zero, then it is called plane stress condition. If the stress distribution in the thickness direction, it is considerable, then it is called the plane stress condition. So plane stress is the stress distribution in the z direction is zero. Plane strain condition, that is in stress distribution in z, x and y and z, is considerable in all the three directions. Stress is available, stress is considerable amount. So that is given in the bottom picture. You can see how the stress is distributed in the x direction, y direction, z direction, in thick plate. So that is called the plane strain condition. So why it is important? Why that plane stress or plane strain condition is important? I will come back to that in the next slide. So K1C fracture toughness evaluation, critical stress intensity factor in modern fracture. And you have to follow certain procedure. ASTM standards are there, 647E, that will give the procedures for the ASTM 647E, will give the procedure, standard procedures for the K1C, fracture toughness testing. And first, you have to, even if you evaluate A1C, that should be validated. Specimen preparation is very important. Testing procedure is very important. And calculation of K1C value is also very important. We'll see one by one. Right. So why the plain strain condition is important? Why we need to prepare the specimen? In such a way that the plain strain condition is meeting. Okay, so if you see this picture, this diagram, there is three specimens. One is thin specimen, the left side, and the middle is medium thickness, and the other one is the last one is thick specimen. So if you draw a graph between thickness, x-axis you take thickness of the specimen, and y-axis you take the fracture stress. You know fracture stress is. What is fracture stress? If you do ordinary tension test, you do the ordinary tensile test and find out what is the tensile strength. And then after tensile strength, maximum ultimate tensile strength, the curve will come down and it fractures. So that is the last point where the specimen breaks into two pieces. That stress is called as the fracture stress. So evaluate fracture stress for all these three specimens. Okay. So when you draw a graph like this, so initially thickness is lower, the fracture stress is higher. Okay, when the thickness is low, small, the fracture stress is higher. And you can increase the thickness of the specimen, x-axis is thickness of the specimen, y-axis is fracture stress. If you increase the thickness of the specimen, the fracture stress is decreasing. And after a critical thickness, particular thickness, then the fracture stress remains constant. What are the thickness? For example, you are testing a specimen which is having 10 millimeter thickness. Then you are testing with 15 millimeter thickness. Then you are testing with 20 millimeter thickness. Then you are testing 25 millimeter. Then you are testing 30 millimeter, 35. Like that, you are testing some five different thickness of specimen. Specimens with different thicknesses. So 10 mm, 15 mm, 20 mm. If you see the fracture stress, it keep on decreasing. Fracture stress keep on decreasing. But after 25 mm, 30 mm, 35 mm, the fracture stress remain constant. Why? Why it is? Why it is happening? It is mainly because of after a critical thickness, maybe for 25 mm, after 25 mm thickness, beyond 25 mm thickness, what are the thickness you use? Okay, 25, 40 or 50 or 60, the fracture stress will not change. Fracture stress is remain same. So that's why the planes, because why it is? The plain strain fracture occurs there. But in the initial case, it's a mixed mode of fracture. It's either ductile mode and the ductile plus brittle mode. But in the last case, when the thickness is greater than critical value, then only you will get a brittle fracture. So in the fracture toughness, one of the requirement, if you see that, one of the requirement what I showed here is, brittle fracture. So this condition should be satisfied. This condition should be satisfied. So that's why you need to prepare the specimen in such a way that will be falling in the plain strain fracture condition, not on the plain stress. Plain stress or mixed mode fracture. The specimen you have to prepare, the thickness you have to select, choose, the fracture should occur in the plain strain condition. Because if you choose a smaller thickness specimen, the fracture stress, fracture toughness, everything depends on the thickness of the material. Okay, if it depends on thickness of the material, it is not a property of the material. Okay, the property of the material means irrespective of thickness, what are the thickness used, the property remains same. Okay, property should be same value. It's not changed with respect to, sir, I am using 10 mm thickness, I am getting 500 megapascal. In 15 mm, I am getting 400 megapascal. In 20 mm, I am getting 300 megapascal. If it varies with respect to thickness, same material, then it is not a material property. So 25 mm, I am getting 300 megapascal. 30 mm, I am getting 300 megapascal. 40 mm, I am getting 300 megapascal. So then it is the material property. So you have to get the material property. So you have to prepare the specimen when you are selecting. The thickness should be, it is greater than the critical thickness. This should be verified. That is, then only you will get the plain strain fracture condition. So plain strain fracture condition means it is thicker specimen where the fracture stress remains constant. Whatever the thickness used, it remains constant. Okay, after the specimen thickness, there is a formula here. You can verify it, you can do it. And see, it's, the formula given is K1C divided by sigma naught. Sigma naught is yield strength of the material. K1C is the fracture toughness of the material. That's a critical stress intensity factor. In mode 1 condition, B is the specimen width thickness, and W is the width of the specimen. And it's A naught, W minus A naught, width of the specimen minus A naught, initial crack length. And A naught is the equation. So these values should be thickness or initial crack length that should be greater than the combined value of the K1C and the divided by yield strength into 2.5. So this condition should be satisfied when you do the fracture toughness testing. Right, there are different specimens are there to evaluate K1C. That is, one is the compact tension, very widely used CT specimen. The paper used to say CT specimen, compact tension. Compact tension means the specimen size is very, very compact, very, very small. Okay, yeah, it's, the dimensions are there. You can refer ASTM 647E, standard, lot of details are given. Not only compact tension specimen, you can use, people are, will be using bent specimen, 3-point bent specimen. So the notch will be here, the crack, you have to introduce a notch. Okay, machine notch, then fatigue pre-cracking. I will come back to that. So the these are the 2 points. S is the distance between the two supports, span length. It is called as the span length. S is called, capital S is called as the span length, and the B is the thickness, and W is the width. So here the relationship is given. Crack length should be equal to the thickness, and the width of the specimen is equal to twice the thickness. So in the compact tension specimen, and here in 3-point bent specimen also, the A should be equal to B, that is crack length is equal to thickness of the specimen. And W, crack length means what? The initial crack length, what you are making. Okay, you have to make the specimen. Mechanically, you have to make the crack. So the crack length should be equal to the thickness of the specimen. And W, width of the specimen should be 2 times the thickness of the specimen. And the S is the 8 times the, S means the span length, that should be 8 times the thickness of the specimen. So all depends on the thickness of the material, and you have to make the specimen, whether CT specimen or the bent specimen. If it is a round specimen, you can use this round specimen also, people are using for evaluating K1C. And this is a photograph of the CT specimen. You can see different shape. Okay, this is a very big specimen and a smaller specimen. Test piece of 10 cm thick, test piece of 2.5 cm thick. Smaller thickness, you can go for the bent specimen. Okay, so how you can make the notches? Because it is very important part. The fracture toughness testing, very important part is the machining the notches. Select the specimen dimensions, what is the thickness, what is the width, everything you decide. And select the crack propagation direction. Because crack, if you don't make notch, machine notch, what, as I don't know, you can make the machine notch using the wire cut EDM process. Very sharp notch you can make. So you have to locate which location, which zone, which region you want to evaluate the fracture toughness. Okay. So the fracture toughness will differ in different directions, different variations will be different. You have to decide where you want to evaluate. Okay. Whether you want to evaluate at the center or in the edges, you have to evaluate and make the machine, the using wire cut EDM, make the notch. So this is the notch. After machining the notch, you have to do the pre-cracking, fatigue pre-cracking. Fatigue pre-cracking means what? You have to load the specimen in the fatigue testing machine. Okay, yesterday I showed, no, instant fatigue testing machine, servo hydraulic control, push-pull type testing machine, and run the machine at a lower frequency, applying a small load and the control condition, because the crack has to grow. If you don't make fatigue pre-crack, what will happen? At the tip of the notch, machine notch, the crack will diversify. Crack will be grow in different directions. Okay, in many crack branches will come out. To avoid that, because you need to monitor and measure the crack deformation, so you have to make a fatigue pre-crack. So the total crack length is machined notch length plus fatigue pre-crack length. So this is a common combined of these two length is known as the initial crack length, 2A. What I told you, 2A. 2A should be machined notch length plus fatigue pre-crack length. Okay, that you have to maintain here. You see the crack tip, how the stress is distribution from the crack tip it is going up, slightly away from the track tip, and away from the track tip is just again it is decreasing. Right, so this is the setup. It's a 3-point bent specimen setup. Then once the everything is made, specimen is made, and in the crack, you have to insert the clip gauge. There are the specific clip gauges are there, COD gauge. People used to say COD gauge, crack opening displacement gauge. So when the load is applied, pulling load or bending load, whatever the load applied, the crack will open up. When the crack open up, the gap between the crack opening and clip gauge will be widened. Once it is widened, that will be sensed and that will be recorded in the by using a computer data logging system. You can record and you will get a beautiful graph, different graphs you get. So end of the resultant is like tensile test, you are getting the stress strain curve. And in the fatigue test, the SN curve, you are getting the stresses number of cycle. And in the fatigue crack growth, you are getting the crack length versus number of cycles. So similarly here, the clip gauge, the outcome of the clip gauge that will be connected to the now it is the everything is programmed, the machines are capable of recording directly, and you get this type of graphs. Okay, so it is all output of the COD gauge. COD gauge is crack opening displacement gauge. It is inserted here. Even in the tension test, when you do tensile test, you will insert the strain gauges. Okay, the strain gauges will measure the strain and they will produce the stress versus strain and diagrams. Similarly, here the COD gauge will record and produce this type of graphs. So there are you will get three different types of the load displacement graph, load versus notch displacement. It is not the displacement of the machine or the column or RAM, nothing. It is the displacement of the notch which you machine there. Okay, so three different types of graphs. So in this graph, what you have to get, you have to get the peak load, or you can say it is a pop-in load. We used to say here it is a pop-in load. What is pop-in load? The load keep on increasing. Okay, when the crack grows, it keep on increasing. Then after reaching a maximum point, then it will start decreasing. So in the there are three types: type 1, type 2, type 3. Three graphs are there, three recordings are there, load versus notch displacement. Out of three, the type 3 is giving a clear cut, a definite peak load. PQ is the peak load. Okay, PQ is the peak load. The type 3 means what? Some of the material, brittle material will give this type of type 3 curve. Okay, and the type 1 curve, you see that there is no popping, it's keep on increasing, there is no peak load. We cannot get the definite or specific peak load. Then what you have to do, you have to apply some criteria, like what we do for the yield stress evaluation or yield strength evaluation, 0.1% yield strength, 0.2% yield strength. Similarly here, you have to draw for this graph, type 1 graph, you have to draw a tangent. Let's say x1 is the tangent of the line. From the tangent x1, you reduce the 10% of the tangent and draw another line parallel to the x1. So where it is the intercept, the point PS, it is intersecting at the point PS. The PS is equal to PQ. PQ is nothing but peak load. Is it clear? So you have to draw a tangent line for the original curve, original load displacement curve, and find out what is the angle of tangent. Angle of tangent, you find out what is the angle of tangent. Whether it is 60 degree, 70 degree, 80 degree, you find out. So from that, you reduce the tangent value to the 10% lower. Okay, 10% lower. Suppose the tangent angle is, for this case, it is the 70 degree, you reduce 10%. So 70 minus 10 is 60. So 60, with the angle of 60, you draw a line, but parallel to this x1. So where it intersects in the actual curve, you see that. So it is intersecting at a point PS. That point is, you take it as the PQ, peak load. Okay, this is the type 1 of this type of curve, load displacement curve, will occur if the material is highly ductile. Highly ductile material. Highly ductile means the percentage of elongation is more than 20%, 25%. So this type of fracture, you'll get the low displacement. But in the second, this one is a medium ductile. So type 1 is highly ductile. Type 2 curves you'll get for the highly brittle material, and type 1 is medium ductile material, that is quasi cleavage fracture, or it is a combination of mixed mode fracture, then you'll get. But even in the type 2, after PQ, it is coming down, the curve is sloping down, then it is increasing. But you can take the PQ as the peak load. That's what you have to take. Why you have to evaluate this peak load? Okay, peak load is very, very important, because I'll show that. So in this equation, this is the fracture toughness equation. You have to calculate KQ. Fracture toughness is denoted as KQ here. And in this equation, for the given specimen, you know what is the B. Specimen thickness, you know. Width of the specimen, you know. And the span, if you are doing 3-point bent specimen, what is the span length, that you know. Okay, the crack length, A, you know. And width of the specimen, that is also you know. And the only unknown thing is, which is unknown thing? P. P is the unknown thing. That only you are evaluating by using that procedure. Whatever procedure I told, you are evaluating P. That P is, you substitute here that PQ value, whatever PQ value you are getting. So type 1 is for IV ductile materials like aluminum alloys and austatic stainless steel. They are all highly ductile material. Okay. And type 3 is the highly brittle. It's not ductile, highly brittle materials, cast iron. Okay. Those comes under the composite material. They comes under the type 3. Type 2 is in between high strength, low alloy steels. Okay. And it's a ferritic stainless steels. So they come under the type 2 category, titanium alloys. They all comes under the type 2 category. So based on the material, you will get the load displacement graph like this. Okay. So from these graphs, you have to, what are the graph you get? Whether the first type or the second type or the third type is immaterial. Only thing is, you have to find out what is the peak load. Okay. In the type 2 and type 3, PQ is very clear. Okay. So the curve itself, you can find out the load is dropping. But in type 1 material, you will not find a definite PQ. Then you have to apply this criteria. Okay. 10% lower than the slope of the original curve. That you get the PQ. So this PQ value, substitute here. And if you substitute all this value, you will get a value called KQ value, fracture toughness value. And you see that for bent specimen, the F is function of A by W. A by W means crack length divided by W. So here, this is for bent specimen, you have to apply this formula, bottom formula, and you have to get what is the F of A0 by W. A0 is the initial crack length. W is the width of the specimen. So once you find KQ, go back to the equation, what I showed earlier, this equation. So here, you have to substitute, instead of K1C, you have to substitute whatever the value you are getting, that KQ value, substitute here. Okay. Sigma naught is, you know, it's a yield strength, everything, other things are known. So when you substitute here, this should satisfy, this equation should be satisfied. The value should be, this value should be lesser than thickness. The B is what? B is thickness. And it should be lesser than W minus A naught. Or it should be lesser than A naught. Okay. If it is less, your value is, whatever the KQ value you are getting is valid. If it is not valid, if it is not following this, at least it should be equal, or it is greater. If it is not satisfied with the condition, what you have to do? You have to change the specimen thickness. You have to go for the higher thickness. If it is satisfied with once in the first instance itself, then fine. But if it is not satisfied, then you have to make another specimen with higher thickness. Okay, when you do higher thickness, again you follow the procedure. These graphs, and then you get the value PQ, substitute here, get the KQ, and do that. Okay, so it is a cumbersome process, but normally people, what they will do, they will use this formula. Okay, they will take the K1C value nearer to that material. They will find the material, where the, how much is that, they will substitute, and they will get the value, and they will safely, they will select higher thickness than this value, what we are getting here. So this is one challenging task in this procedure. Right. So this is the specimen cross section. So the first one is A naught. See the dark region from the top. So B is the thickness of the specimen. W is the width of the specimen. So in the width direction, you see that there is a dark region, top dark region. The top dark region is nothing but machined notch. By using wire cut medium, you are machining the notch. Okay. And then you are doing the fatigue pre-cracking. petty pre-cracking. By doing petty pre-cracking from machine notch equal to the, suppose if you want to make some 6 millimeter crack length, A notch should be 6 millimeter. What you have to do? You have to make a 3 mm machine notch using wire cut medium, 3 mm thick depth. The remaining 3 mm, you have to run it in the petty testing machine, and you have to make that reaching the 6 millimeter. Once it reaches, then you go for the fracture toughness testing. Insert the clip gauge from the top, and the clip gauge will run the crack open up when you apply the stress. Then the clip gauge will record what is the displacement, and that will be given in the form of that. So you will have the machine notch on the top, pre-cracking on the combinedly called as the crack length, and W is the remaining length. W minus A naught is what? The remaining portion, remaining area. We have seen here in this slide, W minus A naught. So this W minus A naught is the ligament. That is remaining area. W is the total width, and A naught is the crack length. The remaining, how much material is going to withstand your applied stress? That's the ligament. Okay. So that is the different regions. So typical K1C values for different materials, K1C values are given in this table. I think it's visible. And you see that yield strength is also given for comparison. And what do you infer from here? If the yield strength is high, higher yield strength material, the fracture toughness is higher. So it's a managing steel, 1730. You are getting fracture toughness 90 MPa root meter. For aluminum alloy, 7075, it is 500 megapascal yield strength. It is only 24 megapascal root meter. So it is, there is a relation, strength is high, fracture toughness is high. So there is a relationship between the strength and the fracture toughness. So what is the use of this fracture toughness? Why, sir, why we need to evaluate all this? K1C and other things. So K1C value of material is known, and the presence of crack is allowed. We can then monitor the crack propagation during service prior to failure. How long we can use, already I told you, by using NDT method, eddy current, many NDT methods are there. You can detect the crack, you can measure the crack size, then you apply this formula. Crack length is known, then fracture toughness is known. Very easy, what is the fracture stress? Okay, so the only thing is, you should know what is the crack length. For that material, you should know what is the fracture toughness. So if these two things are there, you can evaluate the what is the fracture stress. So fracture stress, you see that high K1C. High K1C means that's the top curve. Okay. And the low K1C, crack length in the x-axis, y-axis is allowable stress. Allowable stress. For example, you have a crack length. Okay, there's a dotted line. From the x-axis, there is a vertical line. That crack length is, you consider the crack length is 10 millimeter. Just assume it is a 10 millimeter. So I have two materials. One material is the low fracture toughness material, and another material is high fracture toughness material. Which is low fracture toughness material? The bottommost curve. Okay, low K1C value. So for this crack length, same crack length, 10 mm, both the material, the crack length is same, 10 millimeter here, 10 millimeter there. Okay. For example, you take aluminum alloy, 7075 we have seen here. 7075 we have seen here, 24 megapascal MPa root meter. Same in the titanium alloy, 57. Okay, so you consider this. So this is aluminum alloy, low K1C value. So the allowable stress, you see that. What is the allowable stress? Below this stress only, okay, below this stress, 100 megapascal. Just for example, let's say 100 megapascal is the safe. You cannot apply beyond 100 megapascal, then crack will occur. So for the high K1C, high fracture toughness material, you can allow this, the fracture, the allowable stresses, it will be around 300 megapascal. So by knowing the fracture toughness value, you can identify, you can design what is the allowable stress even in the presence of the crack without failure. Okay, that is the usefulness of this fracture toughness value. So what are the variables that will affect the fracture toughness? Metallurgical factors. Microstructure will influence, inclusions will influence, impurities, composition, chemical composition, heat treatment methods, procedures, and thermomechanical processing, and test condition, temperature, strain rate, specimen thickness, all will influence the fracture toughness value. So the graph is shown here, temperature. If temperature is increasing, Okay, temperature is increasing from minus 300 to plus 300. The fracture toughness value is increasing. If temperature is lower, at lower temperature, fracture toughness is lower. Okay, fracture toughness is lower at lower sub-zero temperature. But yield strength is higher in the lower temperature. But in the, if the temperature increases, yield strength will be decreasing. So it is opposite. So K1C, that's your fracture toughness value, is your temperature decreases, K1C will decrease. Strain rate increases, specimen thickness increases, then K1C will decrease. So this is the effect of the various factors on the fracture toughness value. Right, there is a plasticity correction, which is known as the plastic zone. We should know about the plastic zone. I don't know, but stress is magnified and other things are happening here. And this tip of the crack, you see that this is a V notch. Okay, the load is acting in the y-axis direction, load is acting. And so nearer to the tip of the notch, a plastic zone will be created. So even though you apply, the applied stress is less than yield strength. Okay, what is the concept? If the stress is lower than yield stress, plastic deformation will not occur. Am I right? From the beginning, the tensile test method, I'm saying that if the applied stress is lower than the yield stress, then plastic deformation will not occur. It is true. It is true when there is no notches, when there is no cracks present in the material. If the cracks are present in the material, okay, tip of the crack, even the applied stress is lower than the yield stress, the tip of the crack, nearer to the crack, the material will undergo plastic deformation. Miniature plastic deformation will occur nearer to the tip of the crack. You see that the tip of the crack, sigma naught is the yield stress. Sigma naught is the yield strength of the material. But what happens here, in the tip of the notch, it is crossing the yield strength. Okay, maximum stress at the tip of the notch. Then it is decreasing. So there is a region. That region is called as the plastic zone. The plastic zone will have a diameter. They are assuming that here is a circular region. They are assuming it's a circular region, and this half of this plastic zone is they are taking as the plastic zone size RP. RP is the plastic zone size. Plastic zone size. So in the presence of sharp crack, the plastic zone size ahead of the crack tip varies dependent on the sharpness of the crack. So plain stress condition, that means plain stress means what? Thin specimen. If you are using thin specimen, you can use this formula, RP, to find out the plastic zone size. And 1 by 2 pi k square by sigma naught square. And plain strain condition, you have to take the 1 by 6 pi k square and sigma naught square. Okay. So these are the two different equations developed for the based on the thickness of the specimen. Thin specimen, it will fall under the plain stress condition. Plain strain condition for thick specimen. These are the conditions you can measure. And this plastic zone size is important for the other, the development of the CTOD, J integral and all those things. So CTOD, crack tip open displacement, is also a fracture toughness. So it's one way of measuring the fracture toughness of the material. So for materials that exhibit certain extent of plasticity before failure. So whatever we discussed earlier, it is a brittle material. It should go to the only, that's why you are introducing a machine patch, you are introducing a fatigue crack, re-cracking, then you are breaking. So there is no possibility of deformation, plastic deformation there. Failure will be like a brittle failure. But some material, even if you introduce a machine notch, even if you introduce a fatigue pre-cracking, okay, there will be some amount of plasticity, it will undergo plastic deformation, then failure will occur. So those materials, the CTOD values are good. So unstable crack growth will occur. Failure of specimen near the crack tip does not immediately cause failure in transition zone. Need to increase the load for the propagation of the crack, controllable stable. So this is the diagram is given here. So COD, crack opening, there's a plastic zone size. So during this region, the material will undergo plastic deformation. Then only the brittle failure will occur. Okay, so we will see that. The same procedure is same, similar to the same what we have discussed in the previous one. Only thing is the CTOD you have to include the plastic zone region in the calculation. Okay, so you see that CTOD is given by, that's a deflection, delta is nothing but deflection, 4 sigma by E 2A RP square root. So what is sigma? Sigma is the upright stress and E is what? Young's modulus. And A is what? Is half crack length. And RP is what? Plastic zone size. Okay, so if you know this, then you can calculate the CTOD of the material. So this is also, the displacement will be given by, it's also related to the fracture toughness value. How much is the delta? If delta is high, then it is a highly high fracture toughness. If the delta is lower, then it's low fracture toughness value. Because the materials, some of the materials, please understand the difference between K1C and CTOD is same. The procedure is same. But here, the materials which are undergoing plastic deformation. Which material will undergo plastic deformation? If you see into this picture, the graphs, the first is type 1. Type 1 will undergo plastic deformation. Type 3, it will not undergo because it shows definite PQ value. No need to go for a CTOD or J integral for this type 3 material. Type 2 also, there is no need to go for the CTOD or the J integral. For only for type 1 material which are highly ductile, only the highly ductile material will deform plastically, the plastic deformation will occur. So these material, we are not getting proper definite specific PQ value. So there will be some discrepancy when you apply this, you are assuming more 10% lower, 20% lower, when you are assuming that. So there will be some discrepancy. To avoid this discrepancy, they are going for the CTOD test. Okay, CTOD. And so if the CTOD will give delta, the delta can be calculated using this formula. And J integral is another method. It's a more comprehensive approach to fracture mechanics of lower strength ductile material. Low strength ductile material. For example, you are having aluminum alloy 6061. It is a lower strength. It's only you have a strength of 300 megapascal. It's highly ductile. The elongation, if you measure percentage of elongation for 6061 aluminum alloy, it will be around 25 to 30%. So those material, it is if you want to get K1C value, you use a thick specimen, then only the plain strain fracture condition will be, plain strain condition will be attained. If you use thin specimen, 12 mm, 10 mm, you will not attain the plain strain condition in those material. So if the material is expensive, you don't have much material for making specimens, so it's better go for the J integral. So J integral is what? It is a similar, the testing procedure is similar to the fracture toughness K1C, but you need to prepare series of identical specimens. Okay, each specimen you should have a different crack length. Okay, you have to prepare the specimen with a different crack length. 10 millimeter crack length, 15 millimeter crack length, 20 millimeter crack length. So make 3 different specimens and do the test and find out this load displacement curve. So you will get a graph like this. Okay, the area under the curve is known as the energy, that is, I told in the beginning also, the tension test also, the strain energy is the load area under the curve in the elastic region. So that for each crack length, you will get the energy, what is the energy it is taking, and that will be converted. And here you see that, so we have B is the thickness of the specimen, W is the width of the specimen, and the A is the, including that, delta A is average, and the crack length is A and B is the remaining ligament length. And for 3-point bent specimen, J integral can be calculated using 2A by B into B. And the compact tension specimen, J integral can be calculated using this equation. Alpha is again the geometric factor that can be evaluated, calculated using this expression. So A is area under the, so in the first equation, you take the first equation for 3-point bent specimen. Okay, 2A divided by BB. What is A? Capital A. Capital A is area under the load displacement curve. So you are making a specimen with 10 mm crack length and you are constructing the graph like this and you find out what is the area under this graph. So that is the area under the load displacement curve. And B is the specimen thickness, that we know what is the thickness we are using. And small b is the ligament, that's the remaining thing after the machine notch, fatigue pre-cracking, plastic zone correction, everything you have to take here. And then you have to substitute here. B is unbroken ligament, W minus A. W minus A is the B. So you substitute that, you will get the J integral. And so for different crack lengths, starting from 5 mm, you are preparing one specimen, you are getting one J value. For 10 mm crack length, you are getting another J value. For 15 mm crack length, you are getting another J value. For 20 mm crack length, you are getting another J value. So all the J values, okay, each specimen you plot. So the x-axis is crack length, the crack length of the initial, the crack length of the specimen, okay, 5 mm, 10 mm. So for the corresponding J value, you plot. Then you will get a curve like this. And here, which is critical? Which is critical? Where the critical J1C, J integral also critical, which is the critical J value. So for that, you have to draw a blunting line. For drawing a blunting line, you have to use the formula J equal to using the flow stress of the material. You should know the flow stress of the material. That is nothing but the yield stress of the material and the change in crack length. If you substitute, you will get the J. To that value, you draw a line. So that line where it intersects in the original line, so that is the crack initiation will start here. So that value is the J1C value. So you can get the J1C value like that. And R curve, again, it is a measurement of resistance to fracture. And this is nothing but the Irwin suggestion. Again, the R versus crack length. This is the graph is drawn between R. It's a resistance. R is nothing but resistance to fracture that we are measuring. And that you are relating with the crack length value. So Irwin suggested that the failure will occur when the rate of change of strain energy release rate, rate of change of strain energy release rate, that is, strain energy is what? G. Okay, G is the first remember, because the first slide I told, strain energy is denoted by G, capital G. So dou G by dou A. Okay, that is the rate of the change in strain energy release rate. And it's if it is equal to the rate of change in resistance of the crack wall. So resistance here is R. Okay, so if it is equal, then the failure unstable crack growth will occur. So you have to evaluate what is the resistance to crack, and that is so for different loading condition, if you increase the loading condition, the G1, G2, G3. So you see here, G1 is greater than G2, G2 is greater than G3. That means what? G1, G2, you can directly apply. You can apply by means of loading, by improving load, and the x-axis is the crack length. So different specimen, you make different specimens with different crack lengths and do the test. Okay, apply the different loading and you plot that. Then, so this you will get the red curve concentrate the R curve region. So that's a critical crack length, which will be the crack length where it is AC. The crack beyond that value, AC value, if you have the specimen having the crack length greater than AC, then unstable crack growth will occur. So this is for the ductile material, left side, and the right side is for the brittle material. Brittle material, you will get the horizontal line, because there is not much, once the critical crack length is reached, then there is not much plastic deformation in the brittle material. That's why the curve becomes horizontal. Okay, brittle material, there is no plastic deformation. So it will withstand the load till it is the maximum load. Then it will suddenly it will fail. So that's why the red line, the red curve is the actual curve, R curve, that remains horizontal. Horizontal means parallel to the x-axis. So x-axis is crack length, and y-axis is the resistance to the fracture, and that you can evaluate by using this. So finally, toughness of materials, to obtain material with high toughness, small and round particles, that will, if you have second phase particles, okay? Second phase particles means what? Precipitates, lot of precipitates. Okay, carbides, nitrides, so many things are there in the precipitates. Those small and round particles reduce pileup of stresses. Should be widely spaced, the piling will be the particles also, no, it's not, should be agglomerated one, uniformly distributed. And if it is uniformly distributed all over the matrix, then the proper volume fraction should be maintained. Inclusions should be avoided. A large widely spaced inclusions are less damaging. Fine grain size, it's a minimize the dislocation pileup of stresses. High crack detection, more energy absorbed during fracture. So these are the things that will, you know, you will get the high toughness. If you want to get high toughness, you should have the second phase particles should be smaller, finer, and It should be round in shape and it should be uniformly distributed, and dimension should be a minimum, and then you will get the high toughness of the material. So you have to do the processing of material using these methods. Okay, so then you can, now you can design the grind size, you can design the microstructure. There are advancements that have taken place. I want 20 micron grind size. You can do it, you can design it. Now a lot of softwares have come, and the method, if you follow, then you get approximately 20 micron size grind size you can get in the material. So this is about the fracture toughness. I don't know how much time. Okay, it's already 5:22. Dilakar, can I take questions or?
Yes, sir. We'll take questions, sir. Take questions.
Okay. Yes, sir. Yesterday we didn't take questions.
Okay. Yes, sir. Let me, sir. First question, Subara asked, Subara, okay. Sir, how are the crack dimensions are measured?
Crack dimensions?
Yes, sir. For infinite and finite plane path, plane both.
Yeah, it's, as I told you yesterday, there are two methods. One is the manual method. When I did PhD, you know, I used to measure using a manual method. So the crack one, because we're in all petty except SM behavior, petty crack growth, fracture toughness, K1C, J1C, and even for the CTOD, you can measure. Because you are introducing a notch, machine notch, after machine notch, you are doing pre-cracking to some extent. So total crack length, initial cracking, you are going to fix in the specimen. What is the initial crack length? I told you, A0. That initial crack length you are going to fix. That the initial crack length is, there is a ratio, as I told you, W, that's a thickness of the specimen, is equal to the, if you have a specimen of 25 mm thickness for high strength low-lie steel, 25 mm thickness. Thickness is 25 mm. You fixed. Okay. I'll go to that slide. Are you able to see the slides, no?
Yes, sir. We are able to see, sir. We are able to see, sir.
Yeah. So if you take the first one, CT specimen, I want to do compact tension specimen because you'll get many number of specimen in this material. So if you, the crack length we have to decide. What is crack length here? Because the A is the crack length. You see that there is a two holes in the specimen where the two holes are. The arrow mark is there. P. P is nothing but the load is applied. Okay. Through that there is a, it's a, it will be clamped. In the picture, the machine picture, then load is applied. So from that loading point, is not the entire length of this. The A is marked. So that in the A mark, no, there is half of the distance is machine notch. Then you have the petty crack growth, pre-crack notch. So that is called A. So that A you have to decide. So if you are using 25 mm thickness specimen, you want to evaluate fracture toughness for 25 mm thick specimen, then the crack length should be 25 mm. That 25 mm, as I told you, no, this picture, okay, this 25 mm. So this whatever, no, it's the A naught is the crack length, and the WB is the thickness. So B is 25, and this A naught is 25. So in the 25, the top dark region is you can take 10 millimeter, and the pre-cracking 15 millimeter. Combining it is 25. Okay, so the based on the thickness, you have to decide the what is the length of the crack. Once the length is decided, crack length is decided, then width of the specimen, 2 times the thickness. So the width of the specimen is 2 times. Thickness is 25, then W is 50. So this is the composition you have to make the specimen. So now, after making the specimen, what is the remaining length? The W is what? 50 mm. And A is what? 25 mm. So remaining 25 mm is there. So in the 25 mm, you can measure using the but in the fracture toughness, there is no crack growth measurement because it is, we are pulling it, you are breaking the specimen after that. Only in the petty crack growth, you are measuring, you are monitoring the crack growth because there the load is very low, number of cycles are acting, then you have to measure the crack. So if for measuring the crack length, you can use a magnifying lens. And by pasting a graph sheet And in the graph sheet, know the minimum. What is the minimum value in the graph sheet? It is one millimeter. Okay, every millimeter you can get. So one block you have 1 centimeter. Within that you have 10 small blocks. So 1 millimeter you can measure using the back by using the paste the graph sheet here under the crack length, and you monitor the crack using a magnifying lens and note it down. So this is manual method. And another method is, yesterday I showed the picture. Use a web camera closer to that, and the again paste the graph sheet on the specimen top side just below the crack length, and you apply a liquid penetrant. Okay, so what we apply in the magnetic particle inspection, that penetrant, dye penetrant. You apply on the dye penetrant in the tip of the crack. So the once the crack is opened, the dye penetrant will penetrate toward the crack length. So then you can measure by using the web camera, close camera. Okay, that you can monitor in the computer, and you can note it down for 1 mm how much cycle it takes. So you can, that is the way you can measure. It's a semi-automatic. I can say it is a semi-automatic. The first one is the manual. The second one is because you are capturing the image using the semi-automatic web camera, and you are monitoring it. The third one is, now their AE recorders have come. AE recorder, acoustic emission recorders have come. Those recorders, you know, so they will measure the machine noises. When the crack is opened, the machine noise will differ. The crack length increases, keep on increasing. The machine frequency, the machine, the noise level of the machine will be. So you have to fix the sensors on the specimens, and you can the noise level you can pick up. By the noise level, you can measure the crack growth. So there are many methods are there. You can measure using that.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Consequently, he asked, sir, it is common for both the edge crack or surface crack or separately?
Which one?
This crack measurement can be for both the edge crack and surface crack or any kind.
Yeah, it is both for any crack, because we assume that it is happening in both the, because that's why we are introducing a notch. The crack will be measured in the surface only. Okay, we can see only the front surface and back surface of the specimen. So once the, that's why we are introducing a sharp notch by using wire criterion. Then we are doing pretty pre-cracking. So the crack will go on this direction. So from both the sides, surface crack only we can able to measure. But after the fracture of the sample, you can see the crack. Okay, the crack length you can see like this, as you all know, this one. So the crack length is you can measure. This is machine notch top and petty crack fracture. Then this is the failure region, propagation region. So by after fracture, you can see the different regions. You can see that is possible. But when you are measuring, we can measure only by the surface cracks.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. And Mr. Naveen Venkat asked one question. Sir, strain energy itself depends on resistance. So how do we differentiate strain energy and resistance?
See, the strain energy, okay, the strain energy is, it's a stored energy in the material. Okay, strain energy is what, as I told you, in the tensile graph, the strain energy is what, there is the elastic strain energy and plastic strain energy. Elastic strain energy means within the elastic region, what is the energy it is, what is the deformation it takes. And plastic strain energy is in the underneath plastic plastic region, what is the strain. So this resistance is what, when you apply the strain energy, if you don't disturb the material, the energy will be stored in the material. So if there is no energy in the material, okay, there will not be any resistance. So it will break immediately. The material which are breaking easily, they have less energy, less strain energy, or less cold energy. So this resistance, we are measuring it by different methods. So tensile test is one method, and fracture toughness is another method. Okay, in the tensile test, without fracture, without crack, you are measuring. Here, by introducing crack, you are measuring it. So that's the difference. In the tensile test, we are making any notch there. We are not making smooth specimen we are testing. But smooth condition, that properties are okay. That's fine. That means what? With the in the tensile, all the tensile behavior, we have to consider that it is assumed that there is no crack in this specimen, there is no defect in this specimen, it's a defect-free specimen. But in actual condition, it is not true. As I told, no, all the specimens will have some type of defect, some type of dislocation, something is there in atomic level or nano level or micron level. Micron level you can find out and you can reject it. But in atomic level, how will you find out? There is no technique. So in that case, then you have to know the fracture toughness of the material. So this is all this fracture toughness related things are assuming that if crack is present in the component, if a small crack is present in the component, tiny crack, then how the property resistance will vary. So if you assume there is no crack, then you take tensile properties. If you assume there is a crack in the material, then you take the fracture toughness properties.
Yes, sir.
It's all related. The energy, strain energy release rate, as you told, no, strain energy release rate. If it exceeds the resistance of the material, then only the crack will propagate. If strain energy is resisting, then the crack will not grow at all. It's all related. G is related to K. K is related to fracture toughness. That's why I told, they are all related. Yes, one is within the material. Other one is externally you are applying. When the external load or external stress is lower than the internal stress or internal energy, okay, external energy which you are applying, if it is lower than the internal energy of the material, nothing will happen to the material. Okay, if the external energy is exceeding the internal energy, then the failure will happen. Like to human being, or if you take the present situation, if you have the immunity, okay, until then, no, you can fight with the viruses. If you don't have sufficient immunity, what will happen? The virus will win. If you have sufficient immunity, then you can win. You can win the battle. So it is a battle between internal energy and external energy. Internal energy is stored energy. Within the material, you have some energy stored. How it is getting the material? There are many processing you are doing. By doing that processing, the material is getting the energy. The energy is what? You are measuring in terms of hardness, you are measuring in terms of toughness, you are measuring in terms of strength, you are giving different name. Okay? The material is concerned, it is having energy. That energy, you are measuring different methods and you are naming it different names. Hardness is also energy, resistance to plastic deformation. And the tensile, what is that? It's also resistance to plastic deformation. What is impact of it? It's also resistance to plastic deformation. So all this, no, you are applying externally, you are applying some energy to break the material, to test the capacity of the material, capability of the material, load carrying capability of the material. So the material is having internal energy and you are applying external energy. If external energy is lower than internal energy, the material, the component will sustain, will withstand. If the external applied energy is overtaking or exceeding the internal energy, then the material will fail. This is a simple concept. It will be applicable for all the properties. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Mr. Karnavaran asked one question. Sir, is it possible to avoid micro cracks inside the metal by maintaining sub-zero temperature during manufacturing?
Micro cracks.
Inside the metal by maintaining sub-zero temperature during manufacturing?
No. The crack can be closed sub-zero temperature because its compressive stresses will act on the material. So crack, if any crack is there, that will be closed. But the problem is the material which are DBT, ductile to brittle transition, material which are undergoing ductile to brittle transition, they will change, the microstructure will also change. So if it is for a take now, mild steel. Okay, mild steel at room temperature, you have the ferrite and pearlite, okay, at room temperature. So the same mild steel, if you bring down to minus 60, minus 40 or minus 60, what will happen? The entire thing will change into the mortar structure, hard structure. So what happens? The brittleness will come into play there. So even though you close the cracks, what are the cracks you are present, that can be closed by using sub-zero temperature. By exposing to the sub-zero temperature, partially it will close. Okay, it will not close completely. Partially, all the cracks will be closed. But the problem is side effect. Side effect means what? The material will become, when you expose to the subzero temperature, the material will become the brittleness. Brittleness will come. So normally designers will not prefer, mechanical engineers won't prefer the brittle materials or the material which are failing under the brittle mode. The reason is brittle failure will not give any indication, any warning. We need warning before it fails. I am going to fail. It should tell by some means. Then only those materials are preferred by the design engineers and mechanical engineers. It is one way you can reduce the crack initiation by sub-zero, exposing to the sub-zero temperature. But there are other consequences. Yes.
Yes, sir. Good, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Mr. Praveen Vaidya asked a question. Will there be any use of nanomaterials to improve the material property? Will there be any use of nanomaterials to improve the material property?
Yeah, it is a nanomaterial. No, it's it is as far as the bulk material is concerned, it is nano grind material. Okay, nano grind sized material. It's not nanomaterial. It is a nano grind sized material. So if the grind size is smaller and smaller, finer and finer, you will get better strength and better toughness. So there is a nano, let's say you have to develop the bulk nanomaterial. People are working on it. It has not yet come. But nanomaterials will give four times higher yield strength, higher toughness than the present day material. What are the material we are using today? These are all micron grind sized. Even some materials are produced using near nano grind size. They have produced near nano means the grind size is 500 nanometers, 400 nanometers. But if the grind size is lower than 100 nanometers, then only it will be called as the nano grind material. People are working on it. If it comes, then definitely it will give higher strength and higher toughness because of the finer grinds. Final grinds, grind boundary area will be more, so the resistance offered by the material is more against the applied load. So you will get, definitely you will get improved properties.
Oh, okay. So thank you, sir. And participant, if you want to have any clarification, you can text your questions. I think almost we have answered all the questions.
Yes. So the last lecture on Monday, I will cover the creep behavior and to some extent the impact toughness behavior. So those two are reserved for the last day on Monday. I hope I request the participants, you take any book, any mechanical metallurgy book, then read it. Then only you understand whatever I told. So if you read after 1 month, then you will not remember whatever I told today.
You have to
read immediately. So then you can, these points, it will be remembered by you for quite a long time.
Yes, sir. One participant also asked, sir, can you recommend some of the books for mechanical behaviors?
Yes, I will give on Monday's lecture. Okay, that's whatever I am preparing is based on the Dieter, Mechanical Metallurgy by George E. Dieter. So that is a book, it's a standard book, McGraw-Hill Publications, George E. Dieter. Mechanical Metallurgy. It's a graphic publications. And there are many books out there. Hertzberg, one of their books is there. Hertzberg is there. Even Subra Suresh, he has written a book. I'll give the list maybe on Monday.
And friends, Dieter is really available. So I will share when you send your certificate, if possible. I have the e-copy. So if possible, I send you that these things. Okay, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you.
We'll meet on Monday.
Yes, sir. Tomorrow we'll take rest and we'll meet on
Monday.
Same time. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Participants, thank you so much. So we'll meet on Monday. And also, I wanted to convey one thing. So we are planning for one national conference, which is being scheduled on 17 to 18 of this July. All the papers will be published with in a conference proceeding with ISBN number. Okay, so this is highly needed at this point of time. I feel those who are working in NAC, they very well know. I think so. So due importance is being given for the conference proceeding too. Okay, so those who want to participate in the conference, so soon today, tonight, and to tomorrow, we will be releasing the poster and the way to submit your papers. So you can go out of that, and your paper will be published in proceeding. The proceeding will be available in both e proceeding. And if you want to have a hard copy, then that also you can order later. And so certificate will also be given. E-certificate will be given to all with the photograph if possible. Okay. So thank you so much. Soon we will be releasing this poster. Thank you so much.